This year makes it a decade that you've spent embodying Bucky Barnes. When you were cast way back then, did you have any idea where this role would lead you?
No.
No, not
no,
at all.
Absolutely not. I mean, like, I don't know. It just the whole thing is, you know, kind of a path of its own. You know, I just kind of kept going down the path. I remember when we were first starting out, they had said a couple things of what they would love to see this character do. A lot of those things we already got to see.
I read in another interview you kind of maybe scoffed a little at the suggestion that you had any idea that something like Falcon and Winter Soldier was in Bucky's future. You said they told you kind of what they would like to do, but did you have any idea like a TV season would be in store? And like, once you heard about that, what was your reaction?
No, it's hard to know like where the business is going, or it's definitely hard to know like where Marvel and Disney are going. I think now movies and television is so interchangeable that like the quality has just gotten so much better, you know, in terms of what we're seeing on any medium that way. I was just happy to be included and to keep having, you know, keep exploring this character, keep exploring the storyline. I think we had a very important thing, timely storyline with our show. And I was just happy to be a part of that. I wanted to see that be told, you know, especially after the pandemic. I don't know. I feel like it really empowered us in a way to, you know, want to finish the show and tell the story the right way. And it was just nice to be a part of that.
Right. Was production shut down during the pandemic?
Oh, yeah. 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 We had gotten to Prague. And then we were there for a week, and then it was like everybody was like, go home, you know. So it was like, fuck.
Did the script go through a lot of changes in the meantime? Did they tweak it to sort of reflect what
actually was happening in the world? One of the craziest things about the script and the scripts before that was how timely everything felt. And it was weird to sort of almost see where it was going, even just from the scripts. So to answer your question, I would say no. I mean, like, but weirdly, like, for example, with like the blip, COVID, right? Like the parallels of what was going on in the script and what was going on in our world kind of like freaked us out.
Oh, yeah. It's the first season of Handmaid's Tale, I'm sure.
Yeah. And like, I just feel like it was just much more time, you know, everybody felt more invigorated to go back to work and like to want to tell the story rather than anything else.
I have to ask about the scene that opens episode 4 with Io deprogramming Bucky in Wakanda. It's some of the best work that I've seen within the larger MCU. What goes into filming a scene like that for you? You speak so little, but you say so much. As an actor, how do you get there? And what is that process like?
I appreciate you commenting on that, or just asking about it. I don't know. You know, it was one of those things where like you read the scripts and it's a scene that you feel grateful about as an actor, right? Because you're like, oh, cool. Like, I'm going to get to do this. And then you're really terrified about it because you're like, oh, my God, I have this scene. So I sort of had it marked on my calendar, you know, like, and then I was counting the days, you know, six days till the scene. And there's always this buildup to it because you knew that it had to be some sort of like major revealing scene or giving over of some sort. So it's like, it's not like you have a choice, right? Like, yeah, you're like, no, I have to go there. And like,
there's no half-assing it.
Yeah. But like, I'm just happy about it. You know, I felt from a point of view of the character, it was really nice to have that scene. We'd never really seen him let go, so to speak. I mean, I keep telling Kevin about it. Like, I'm like, he's a big part of Wakanda, you know, but like, he was to some extent, you know, like that's where his journey started again. And it was just nice to have that scene and have it happen there and for us to have that flashback to give us context to everything else that he was doing.
Grузовой вагон.
this season went into Bucky's trauma over what he did as the Winter Soldier. What I'm wondering is, are you interested as an actor seeing Bucky's trauma over being 106 years old? Like, we got into that a little, we saw that a little bit in the universe with Cap, but like, or how do you think Bucky has processed the fact that he's a very old man and in a very young man's body?
I always think with storytelling, the most important thing is to have honesty, you know, and just have people understand and relate to something that you're doing. Mm-hmm. Trauma is obviously something that everybody understands because everyone's experienced some level of trauma, different levels of it. But I think trauma is very relatable. And I think it's very important that, you know, and I love that the MCU was dealing with certain issues that were maybe hard to talk about or, you know, like, and confronting them in a certain way. My goal to everything was always just to provide the most honest answer and take to it all, you know, and just have people relate.
Hey, what are you doing here? How was the date? It was good.
God, I owed you for lunch.
You know, I have a lot of fans that reach out talking, you know, like writing about trauma and telling me about certain situations that they're going through and feeling empowered, like right. from the show or something. And I feel like that's just, that might be the greatest gift, to be honest, because people are experiencing a lot of difficult things. And if for a second they can just, you know, like have another experience outside of themselves with it, I think we've done our job, you know, like that's just the most important thing.
Right. Which is honestly why I was so happy that even though it was court mandated that we see Bucky in therapy. Like, were you surprised when you got those scripts? Like, were you excited?
No. No, I loved it. I was like, oh, this is great, you know? It's like my therapy sessions.
Tell me about your most recent nightmare.
I didn't have a nightmare. Oh, come on, really? You're gonna do the notebook thing? Why? It's passive aggressive.
You don't talk, I write.
Okay.
I think a thing that people forget is that these characters, even though they're superheroes of some sort, and that was one of the things I loved about our show, if I may be biased, you know, about Sam Wilson and Bucky Barnes, is that they're actually not superheroes. They're regular people trying to navigate real life stuff. And WandaVision did this too. I love that, like, you know, the MCU was dealing with situations that was trying to highlight that, like, even though these people have superpowers, they're still traumatized by these issues. Age of Ultron, Thanos and stuff. Like, it's all kind of, you know, navigated for you to see that's pretty traumatic stuff. And, like, right. It's what Marvel is so great at, right? Like, when you're mixing entertainment, like, when you're saying, like, oh, this is entertainment, but at the same time, there's a message there. There's something that connects deeper about it.
That's reflected in its popularity. Like, if it was just entertainment, people can't rewatch that over and over. There has to be.
I don't think we have the patience or the attention span for that. You know, people want to relate. People want to feel. I think sometimes people want to escape, but in a weird way, I think Marvel provides all of that. You know, like, there's an escapism to it, but at the same time, there's a deeper message.
I mean, I'm a relatively sane woman. There's a reason that I see Endgame 3 times in theaters, and that's because it's giving me a catharsis, an emotional catharsis that, you know, it's not just a popcorn flick. It's you know, it taps into something that we all want and we all need.
Well, it's interesting, right? Like, saying goodbye to Robert Downey Jr., or I should rather say Tony Stark, to watch that on screen after 10 years, there's something weird about that. Like, I don't know, you feel connected to it, you're saying goodbye to it. I mean, people have reactions to it, you know, And I don't think we've been in an age where we've been with characters for so long, you know, like where you want to say goodbye to a character in a sense. Same with Steve Rogers. Big characters.
Absolutely. But everyone feels like they know. Well, that's actually leads into my next question, because so much of Bucky's journey in the MCU is connected to specific characters. First Steve Rogers, now Sam Wilson, and your Sebastian's chemistry with both of these men, Chris Evans and Anthony Mackie, as evidenced by all the fan blogs, I assume, is undeniable. Like, is there a process that actors as a collective have to go through to build chemistry, or is it just all luck of the draw?
Believe it or not, I think like an important ingredient to it all is actually having fun.
that makes sense.
Both of the men that you just mentioned are like maybe the best people. Chris and Anthony, like they just have an energy about them that like they walk in and they change the room. You know, that's just who they are.
Right.
That's a natural thing to who they are. But I think both of them have this thing like that I've loved of just embracing people and making people like feel good. You're in that presence, you're immediately uplifted by it.
Right.
To go to work with those people, like it's undeniably going to be fun, or it, you know, it's just going to lead to different things. With Anthony, we were trying to find like a medium of it, and a lot of that came from us just having fun.
Oh, yeah.
and just like not taking ourselves too seriously. You know, we're at the end of the day, we're just two old guys, you know, kind of like laughing about it all. You know, it's so quick, life, everything.
There is a very Stadler and Waldorf element to it sometimes. Like, you can get snipe at each other a little bit. Speaking of which, I would again be remiss if I didn't ask about couples therapy, because that was so delightful watching you two in that scene. How was it to film in such close quarters with Anthony, and finally working through some of you two's issues?
A lot of that scene was improvised. I think we were filming that scene, and in between takes, we walked out and recorded a Valentine's Day video. I said to him, I was like, Anthony, I think you and I have to go on Instagram and tell the people that Valentine's Day is going to be okay. And he was like, I'm in.
Rule one, always make sure to give a gift instead of receive one. That makes you a good person. Rule two, be yourself always and forever with anyone and everyone. That's very nice.
So just to give you context, you know, we're having a lot of fun with it. Yeah. But we knew it was an important scene in terms of the characters, just because it was just saying something about where they were at. And it was the first time that we were learning about how differently they were approaching the issue.
Right.
You know, and it was a great scene. And I think we were searching for the fun in the scene. We knew the importance of the scene.
Sure.
But I think sometimes, like, believe it or not, like going at it from another angle of let's just enjoy the fact that we don't like each other, right? Like sometimes it leads to the heart of the scene in a different way rather than approaching it directly. And we discovered that while we were doing it.
All right, get close. Closer.
Which way?
Why do you have to have your legs open? You know what? Fine. Here. You happy now?
All right. All right.
Yeah.
Good.
We're locked
That's
in.
Fine.
It's a little close.
It's very close. That's what you wanted, right?
Guys. Good. Now look at each other. You need to look at each other in the eyes. There, you see, that wasn't so hard. Wait, what are you doing? Are you having a staring contest? Just blink. Sweet Jesus.
When I told people I was talking to you, they all rattled off a list of roles that they wanted me to ask you about. My wife was like, ask him about Kings. And I was like, is that a question? And she said,
no
just
way.
Do it. Oh, yeah. Like I can't tell you how often Kings comes up in our household. She's in this business. But so I'm going to just say,
Kings.
What about Kings? Do you remember that experience and filming it and
deeply. Deeply, of course. You have to remember, like, that was a big thing for me. Like, at the time, you know, Michael Green, Ian McShane, Chris Egan, like, we had, like, Brian Cox was in that show. Macaulay Culkin was in that show. Like, you know, it was a great show. And it was just a little bit too early, because I think we could have done it now and we could have had, you know, but like.
Yeah. NBC was doing a lot of wild stuff. Too early. like that they ran into that with Hannibal too, like all of these shows that could have
but like, you know, would I even be cast in that show today is a good question.
I think you've done pretty well for yourself. I think they would be lucky to have you.
I would hope so, because it was a great experience. But I always think, like, imagine if we ever did like a second season 40 years later or something.
I gotta tell you, like, there is a cult King's following amongst like entertainment journalists. So
I love that.
I can't believe you don't get asked that more often, to be honest.
I love that. I would love to.
Just tell me so I know. Was it real?
The only real thing I ever touched.
So you mentioned that it doesn't feel that different, and you have been more focused on film lately. How is it now with your latest project, the Pamela and Tommy Lee project for Hulu? Does that just feel like another project? It is so.
No, not, none of it ever feels like another project. You know, like, every project sort of has its own identity,
right,
so to speak, and sort of its own kind of like vibe, if you will. And you just kind of go with that. You got to be curious. Like, right. I feel like when people ask me, like, what do you think is the most important thing? I'm like, just stay curious. Like, stay curious about life, people, experiences, stories. I don't know. Don't be so quick to judge. You know, everyone's got a story. This sort of ended up in my lap. Sometimes I don't know why, but it did. And then you're like, well, I want to tell this, you know, I want to be a part of the telling of the story. But the only thing I'll say about it is, what's interesting to me is people have a lot of preconceived ideas and misconceptions. Boy, like, do we love to project.
That's very,
you know, true. What I mean? Like 2020, like, we are projecting a lot. Do you remember when you could just be surprised by something?
No, I don't. It feels, you know, very, it's like, far removed.
Like, we are very quick to judge. Again, good and bad.
Yeah.
Like, right? Like, there's two sides of the coin always. Yeah. But like, this is an interesting story, you know, because it brings out reactions in people. And I think it's funny to watch people sort of have some reaction to something without even knowing what it's essentially about.
Oh yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And like, we see that all the time. And that's sort of that's
hypocrisy.
We
see it all the time.
Does that drive when you're picking roles? Because you were so fantastic in I, Tonya. That strikes me as another story where like, we thought we knew everything going on there. You know, from the jump, from what was reported, but like, that's a much more complicated story than I think people originally thought.
I gravitate towards really good writing.
Right.
I see things as characters. I see things as stories,
sure,
whether they happen to be based on a true story or real life stories or real people. That's another thing, right? I think you have a responsibility to uphold a certain truth to those people you're representing, but at the same time, it's a story and it's told through a different medium.
Right.
You know, it's not, we're not making a documentary. It's a point of view. And sometimes as an actor, it's not even you're not the writer, you're not the director, you're in this thing. But I appreciate really good storytelling, and to me, I, Tonya was a really well-written thing.
There's more to this than you're telling me, isn't there?
Shut up, Donnie. I'm telling you.
Jeff? Did you do it? God damn it. Shit. The fuck? Jeff! Fuck! What the fuck? I mean, this is my fucking life. This is... skating is my whole fucking life.
I really appreciate our writers on this thing as well. Like, I think they're very talented. I think they're saying bigger things. I get hesitant to talk about it too much, only just because I feel like, you know, people deserve to, you know, they deserve to have the story told before it ends up being sort of like thrown to the commons of it all. But these are very talented people, you know, like, again, with a moral responsibility and with telling a story that's just not like they're saying something with it. There's a message behind it. You know, I'm happy to get behind that kind of storytelling, you know, which is what I felt with Aitania, what I feel with this. People are going to have ideas about it, but they're going to, in the long run, perhaps be surprised about the level of depth that's actually going into this thing. We are in a world where we're depending so much on technology and the internet. And we have to understand the origins of that to some extent. That's and what went into it, you know. And funny enough, this factors into the story.
And to see how people go crazy every time one of those photos from the set surfaces, like it's just kind of feeds into
it. I think it's funny, you know.
It looks like your drumstick skills are really coming along too. So, I mean, congrats on that.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm trying. I had to learn drums. I have no idea. Like, you know, you just go with the flow. All of this is a learning lesson, essentially. You know, you do your best and that's it. You know, I think it's just interesting how people criticize everything so quickly, you know, like, I just want to be like, all right, you got something to say, like, go out there and fucking prove it. You know what I mean? Like,
no, I know.
I'm like, all right, cool. Is that comfortable for you to just say what you want to say right now, you know, like, and it is, people are very comfortable behind a keyboard, you know, but it's like, if you want to meet life and you want to do something interesting or something that lasts, right, you're going to have to do a lot more than type a fucking message.
You're going to have to live, try,
experience,
take risks,
pass it on. Like, yeah. There's a lot of things, you know?
Absolutely. Sebastian, you're the best. Thank you so much for joining
hey,
us this
thanks.
Morning.
Thank,
I know
thanks
you're really busy.
I appreciate it. Thanks for taking the time.